That meeting recording is a progress, and I call this meeting to order at 5:33 PM. I recognize that Aaliyah is here, Joshua is here, Liam is here, Pooja is here, Rahman is here, and Siri is here, as well as ex officio members Tori and Courtney, as well as David, Matthew, and Rashad. And we can go ahead and get started. So everyone has had the chance to look over the agenda, correct? I'm going to assume yes, because you should be looking at them. But there are going to be a few amendments later on in the meeting to fit in the confirmations that Siri talked about last night, but those will happen when we finish our main discussions at the appropriate times. So with that, is there a motion to approve the agenda for tonight? Liam moves in the chat and Pooja seconds in the chat. Any objections? I see or hear no objections. So by general consent, the agenda for September 29th have been approved. We can jump over to the minutes real fast. I'm just going to scroll through these again. And that's all, because it was a pretty short meeting. So if there is a motion to approve the minutes from September 22nd.
I motion to approve the minutes from September 22nd.
Liam seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? All right, I see or hear no objections. So by general consent, the meeting minutes from September 22nd have been approved. And with that, we can start our discussion with Matt. I'm not going to butcher your last name, so I'm just going to call you Matt from ECS. If you would like us to do a quick round of introductions, we can do that real fast so you know who we're who you're talking to tonight. So I'll go ahead and start. My name is Sierra Dubuque. I'm currently serving as the chair of the finance board, and my pronouns are she, her, hers. And we'll just go on in alphabetical order, like last time. So, Aaliyah.
Oh, I thought Arch was here. My name is Aaliyah. I'm the vice chair of the finance board. My pronouns are she, hers, and I am the person who reached out to you in the email about, you know, the stuff.
Absolutely.
Joshua, you can go next because Matt knows who I am.
Hi, Matt. My name is Joshua Gray. I serve as the vice president for student organizations. I use him, he, him pronouns.
Hi, Matt. I'm Liam, and yeah, I use he, him, his pronouns. Nice to meet you.
Hi, Matt. My name is Pooja Patel. I use she, her, hers pronoun, and I serve as a finance board representative. It's good to have you here in the meeting.
Thank you, Pooja.
Hey, Matt. My name is Siri, and I'm the current treasurer of the SGA.
Hi, Siri.
Hi, Matt. My name is Victor Kende. I use AMA's pronoun, and I'm a finance board representative.
Thank you, Victor. So I'm Matt Bowling, he, him, his pronouns. I am the assistant director for event scheduling and advising with Event Conference Services. I'm also currently serving as the staff member who is coordinating student events. So I appreciate you all reaching out to me to have a conversation about event budgets in the upcoming semester. I realize that we're in a very strange space right now with events and student events. So I wanted to get a chance to hear your thoughts and where you're at. But to give you a little background, we don't currently have approval to schedule student events for the spring. We are under the university's current guidance. I have heard nothing to indicate changes to that. We do expect them, but we have not yet heard any word on what changes may look like, what may be authorized, what may not be. Now, I know that's not great for future planning, but I'm trying to find a way to balance where we are currently, which is no events at all, with you being able to plan for the future with event budgets, right? So if you have any questions you'd like to ask, if you have any thoughts you want to talk about, I'd like to hear them before I speak on what I think your best course of action probably for us would be.
Real quick before we get into like the nitty gritty, it was asked earlier in our pre-meeting about what student clubs could do to reach out to you guys and like schedule meetings if they wanted to do contracts and stuff like that. So we were just wondering what sort of that process looks like for them to reach out if there's no like set in stone, here's a time you can meet with me.
Right. So if you are trying to, there's a little bit of gray area here. If you are trying to plan for something that does not require a space, if you are not booking, trying to find a campus space to do what you're doing, if you were trying to, you know, a virtual speaker or something like that, that's going to require money from finance board, but not any actual resources from event and conference services, you can reach out directly to me by email or myself or the schedule account that'll still get forwarded to me. Which is schedule@umbc.edu. And I will set up a one-on-one time to talk about that. I didn't create office hours because we weren't really sure about how that was going to work virtually or what finance board was planning for spring events. But I am available for those meetings if people do need to talk.
All right, thank you. Are there any questions for Matt, or would you guys like to hear a little bit more of background?
Okay, good.
Pooja asked for background.
Okay, yeah, let me, so I think for us, I don't love the idea of planning for events in the spring as they have happened in the past. I don't think we're going to be in a place where the university will be authorizing large-scale student events in person, right? Those big ballroom events, I don't think we're going to be in a place in the spring to be hosting those. There's currently a review process for anybody asking for any events happening right now. And their first criteria is there another way for this to happen? And so I think a lot of those events will be pushed to a different format. Where it's helpful for us in event and conference services to get help from finance board and from SGA is pushing that word to have student groups think a little differently about how they are planning these events, exploring other options or coming up with ideas that allow them to do events in different formats than they're used to still accomplish what goals they're trying to meet. And so when these finance meetings, if we're going to do finance meetings to give people budget estimations, right? I don't want to be running numbers if I can avoid it for these large scale events that we don't think are going to happen, because I don't think that's beneficial for anybody. It's a lot of time that could be used in figuring out how better to handle that event. But I don't know these events well enough to be able to tell people, well, you should do this and you should do that. This is kind of an area where they're going to need to come up with some ideas. And then we can run through them to see what is helpful, what will work, how we can help. So how best can we convey that idea and still say Event and Conference Services is still here to sit down and talk to you and work through your event. We just don't think that these large scale events are going to happen. And how does that affect your process? Or do you desperately want us to go ahead and give these full numbers so you can see that budget picture? That's where I'm a little unclear.
Joshua?
Hi, Matt. So you mentioned the process for evaluating whether or not a event should happen on campus. So can you just speak more to that process, one, and then also who comprises the body that evaluates events and says, yes, this can happen, or no, this cannot?
So right now, that's a leadership committee on campus comprised of some senior leadership in campus life and in health and safety who are making decisions about whether an event is considered mission critical to happen in person. And a lot of that right now is focused on events for students who are on campus right now and engagement of that student population who is authorized to be in campus. So those Friday night events that happen under the tent that are being hosted by the engagement team and the SEB, those sorts of events are really the only thing that are going through that process in that focus right now. And so what that committee is trying to do is evaluate for safety what events could happen in other ways and what mitigating factors, if an event is authorized, need to be put in place for that event to happen. And the bottom lines of those have very much been masks being required, social distancing being observed, and having a space for that event to happen, which in the spring, we don't really have answers yet for what those spaces are going to be, because right now there's a big tent on the North Lawn that is not going to stay up through the winter. That's going to come down when the weather turns, because it's basically an outdoor event space. So when that shuts down, the ballroom isn't really available. It's being used as a study space. The UC third floor is kind of offline to support study spaces for students who are on campus. Our boardrooms are shut down at the moment for events because they don't have the capacity for things to occur in them. You know, if we can only put two people in a conference room, there's not really any use for that conference room. So, you know, these are all issues that we're all trying to sort out, but they all are also roadblocks in the way of student events resuming as they had been happening.
Joshua?
Okay. So a follow-up to that would be, are there any students that sit at the table that help to make those decisions to guide whether or not an event can occur? So this can be a student that's a part of SEB, a student that is a liaison for campus life or something like that, but are there any students informing those decisions, or is it just senior leadership?
It's just senior leadership at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
And again, they're not evaluating content of events. They're evaluating health and safety standards and alternate means of delivery, things like that.
Does anyone else have any questions, thoughts, concerns?
I'm just going to throw something out there just so that we all feel like we've covered our bases. Matt, first of all, thank you for coming in and long time no talk, but good to see you. I think what would be the most helpful as far as finance board moving forward, and I'm also not expecting an answer for this either, so I'm keeping that in mind as well, but as things move forward and as things change or don't change, as far as what's allowed to happen, what can be done on campus, if student orgs are ever allowed in the spring to be doing anything on campus, how can we be working together to make the finance board process work well with you all and your process. Again, that might not be an answer that we have right now, but moving forward, how would you like us to work together?
So all of the work that the finance board put in last semester to update this process is fantastic, and I love it, and it's super helpful to have your evaluations after we've given you budget recommendations. I think that process is a great process. I just want to be mindful, because of where we're at with student events, that we don't have a great answer, and I didn't want to be in a place where we were giving them budget recommendations and then you were giving them budgets and they were assuming that those events were going to happen, right? Because I'm okay to, if someone puts a request in 25 Live, which they can still do, to give them a budget recommendation for that so they can send it to you. But I want to make sure that we're clear in that process that that is not an authorization for an event. That is not an approval for this to happen. This is us being prepared in case something does change, so that we're not at this at the back end at the last minute trying to close those gaps. And so messaging appropriately to these student groups, a united front from all of us, I think is super helpful for us, because we're gonna need space and time to make updates to this. And to roll those out to you and to student event planners.
Our microphone was up and muted and I was talking. assuming, I don't know what's going to happen, none of us do, that next semester might look very similarly to this semester. How much time, deadlines, that sort of thing, do you need if student orgs are looking for contracts? Obviously, those contracts have to be written through ECS. What would be the timeline that you would like for that, seeing as you would be the one that would have to go through those contracts with them?
Right.
Assuming it's all online events.
Right. At this point, I'm looking at probably 6 weeks start to finish, ideally, because we're going to have to pull a lot of information into the new contract, and then push that through to all the places it needs to go, and then get it signed and in place. It can be done on a shorter timeline than that, at a minimum of 4 weeks, but 6 weeks at least would be my preference, and the farther out, the better. I would also say the 25 Live system is still accepting requests, which we are not processing, but if people have an idea for something that they want to put in the system and have evaluated for budget, you know, for us to say it would cost you this much, I'm okay with that, as long as they know that it's not moving forward until the university has given us word, and then we can, you know, come back and make evaluations. But if it puts us in a place, or puts you in a place where you can make some more informed decisions about what your budget's going to look like, I want to help with that.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Joshua?
Yeah, I have one more question, which is basically two questions, but this is my last point. So the first thing is what you just said of like getting ahead and making sure that student organizations know what's going on and that the request won't necessarily be approved, even though they can put it into 25 Live. So what work has ECS done around setting those expectations on the front end and like putting out language to make sure that those are clear? This is just a conversation that we've been having in finance board about setting expectations. So I would love to hear what you guys have been doing around that. And then my second thing is completely different, but as the state of Maryland transitions from stage to stage, so going from like a stage 2 to 3 or whatever when it comes to lockdown and quarantine measures, how does ECS also change the way that you're operating? Or are you just, everything is canceled until higher ups give the indication that it no longer is?
So unfortunately, we are at the mercy of university leadership, and we can only move as far as we, as we've been deemed as okay. So there is not a lot we can put in place. And unfortunately, I don't know what that next decision is going to be on their part, right? They've given us directives of to put us where we're at right now. And I don't know what their next steps for opening are going to look like. So I can't really speak to what we would be doing, because we have to account for all those factors of a decision that gets made. So they tell us, you know, if we go to, when we go to this next phase, we will be able to open meeting rooms for six people. Well, then we have to go back and evaluate all of those spaces and what capacities are and all those moving parts. So until we know what that's going to look like, I don't have a great answer, unfortunately, beyond I don't know what it's going to look like. And we make those decisions as we get the information. We have been following the university's language and information output. So we have not been prepping end users with more information than that, because we just don't have it. We follow what the university has told us. We reiterate to clients what that means from an event perspective, in that, you know, events have been canceled up until this point, and we are not allowed to book new events. We will not be booking new events until something changes. And that's the only information I have to give at this point, because that's all that's coming to us.
Hey, sorry, question. I know his first question was about, like, the language. Like, have you guys, like, been speaking to student orgs and just letting them know, like, your expectations?
We have not yet. I was waiting to see how this was going to go. And once, you know, I had talked to this group, I am going to follow up with a post to the student org schedulers page that we maintain. The few groups that have actually come to us and inquired, I've given them basically the same information I've given you. We don't have an answer yet, because we don't have a process yet, because we don't know where we're going to be in events in the spring. And you know, if they've asked to meet with me about doing remote events or getting a contract written, I've scheduled the meeting and talked to them on a one-on-one basis to see where we could be helpful. But we have not put out any general word to student groups, because we haven't really had any information to update them on. And I'm happy to do so as that information comes in. And so if there's something that we need to message after this meeting, I can put that together.
Yeah, and just to add on, Matt did send out communication for this semester. So they weren't blindsided about spring, or wow, about fall. Matt did a really good job of putting language together, and it was sent out in multiple areas. So they were aware that everything is online.
We just don't have any information for spring yet.
Yeah, I was speaking about spring. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Victor?
Yeah, so I was gonna wait till we get to like to the check-in, but I'm just gonna ask. Okay, so one club reached out to me. So I think it was asking about applying for next semester. The way he put it, I don't think it's in person, it's probably online, but so how is the application for next semester going to go? I don't know if it's going to be through SAS or like normal budget application.
Victor, I think that's a question we can save for later, that we would decide together outside of meeting with Matt.
Yeah. Oh, I don't know. Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? All right, I'm not seeing or hearing anyone, but I guess based off of, I'm trying to formulate this in my mind real fast. Oh, yeah, I'll let Rahman go while I think about my question.
Thank you, Sierra. Matt, I had a quick question regarding the web page for events and conferences or services. Like a couple of my orgs tried putting in a request to meet with someone, but it was just really hard for them to get in touch with someone. So should they just email you directly or?
Absolutely. They can email me directly. If there is some reason beyond, you know, they need something directly. If there's ever a reason that you can't, student orgs are reporting you that they're having trouble reaching event and conference services under any circumstances ever, please reach out to me directly, always. It's my job to make sure that we are communicating clearly. And if that is not happening, I want to know about it. Even more so than, you know, being the person who is coordinating student events right now.
Yeah, of course. And sorry, one more question. So they also asked about how they should prepare for these meetings. Like I don't really remember what they requested, but how should they prepare for these meetings specifically?
Having a general plan of what they are looking to do, bringing to the table an idea that is thought out, at least to the point of being ready to start planning. So they know what event they want to do. They have an idea of where they'd like to host it and what moving parts it may have. That's what I need to see. If it's going to be an on-campus request, they need a 25 live request in the system. It doesn't have to be approved, but they have to have submitted a 25 live request so that I have something to reference. Mm-hmm. And at that point, that is enough for me to sit down and start talking to a student group about what that event would look like and how much it would cost.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
All right. I've got my question now. English has not failed me. But based off of everything that you have, all the information you've given us, specifically relating to, you know, the possibility of on-campus events, but having to go through the system again if those are allowed, one of the solutions that we were thinking of going through was pushing for virtual events for next semester. And then if the university does come out and say, yay, you can have on-campus events on a limited basis, we were wondering what ECS would be willing to do to work with us on like a rebound for all those events to fund them so that we can better support students if you're catching my drift.
I am. If at any point, so what I would like to see ideally is for them to put requests in the system now that we can just sit on until we have more information. If they are putting in 25 live requests, it makes it easier for us to have a reference point, right? Now I have something in the system that I can see and I can read. I know who the contact is. I know what space they were thinking of. And I have something I can reference throughout any communications that I may have with them. But that said, if at any point we get to a point where it seems like events get authorized or are looking likely, or if I'm getting information it's going to go live, then at whatever level that is authorizing student events, we can absolutely start cranking out budget documentation. The more prepared we are for that to happen, the better off and the easier it'll be, because that's why 25 Live is so helpful. I have all my stuff in there, all of our resources, all of our spaces, and anything that's going to cost money. So it's easier for me to spit out a bill to send to them to give them an idea of what it's going to cost. The process is flexible for me. The tools I have to use in that process aren't so flexible.
Yeah, that makes sense. But thank you. Any other questions, comments, concerns for Matt?
So to be clear, I'm going to let student groups know that they can put requests in the system for spring, but that we do not know if events will be authorized, so that they can then pass those budget numbers on to you, but that they should probably reevaluate how they're going to look at events for the spring. Does that make sense?
Matt, do you think before you send that, you, me, Courtney, and Candace could chat about that too?
Absolutely. I would love that. That would be so much easier for me.
Perfect. She's on vacation right now, so I can try to put something on our calendars for next week if that's okay.
That's totally fine with me.
Okay.
I will draft it and hold it until we've talked.
Perfect. I'm also in the mindset of not wanting to like give hopes for things that might not happen.
Hey, I'm on board. I'm just trying to be as helpful as I can.
I appreciate it. I'll put something on our calendars.
Awesome.
All right. I personally don't have anything else, but if anyone has any.
Hi, this is an exclusive announcement.
I don't know what that was, but Rashad, did you unmute it to ask a question? No, okay. All right. Any more questions? Last call. Yes, thank you, Matt, for coming in and talking with us. This has been very helpful for me. I know that much.
Well, thank you for having me. And if I can ever be helpful, please don't hesitate to reach out.
All right.
Bye, everybody.
All right. Thank you for coming. See ya. All right. Okay. Now that we've had our discussion with Matt, we can move on to our discussion with David. I think last 2 weeks ago, it was about reimbursements. He was going to come and talk about us with reimbursements. Hopefully there's an update on the merchandise and marketing fee, but can't get our hopes up. So I'll let David take it away.
Hello, all. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
And see me now, and I have a little background set up, but if anyone wants to know, this is Zion National Park in Utah. Anyone who has the opportunity in the future, once COVID is over, I would highly recommend taking a trip out there. It's one of my favorite national parks. But anyways, yes. I do have a little update with the reimbursement process. I worked with Candace and a student or maybe an assistant from DoIt. And we do have a virtual DocuSign version of the ResGAF that's gonna come out. I think they're still like tweaking out the final approval process, et cetera. But once that is completed, I can definitely go ahead and start processing reimbursements via email. Like if there's any reimbursement requests, we would just have to send me via email like the required documents. And if you guys don't know the documents that I need for reimbursements, I can definitely give those to you. But I think they should be on your website already. But with that, there is a caveat. Like, before there's any reimbursement, like that needs to be requested, or you know, if you get any like questions from groups, the first thing is like before there's any expenditure of any expense, be carryover like the student organization's carryover accounts or their finance board funding, is to just, you have to submit the DocuSign ResGAF first, because that'll go through an approval process via like a campus life representative and the student organization's advisor. So once those approvals go through and I can approve it, like finalize the approval by like, you know, confirming that there's enough funding for the expense, then the you know, student can go purchase something to get reimbursed, or Yeah, like whatever expense needs to be done, whether I can pay with my credit card or there's a reimbursement, the ResGAF is the first step to prior to any expenditure. So that's like the whole point of the ResGAF. With that, like, you know, the reason we need the approval process is to make sure that students aren't going out spending their own money and then expecting a reimbursement if there wasn't if there was like a block in the approval process. So this is what we're trying to do to make sure that nothing gets, you know, people don't have to spend their own money or something occurs that shouldn't have occurred. So, yeah, that's what's going on so far. Is that once the DocuSign ResGAF is finalized, we can go ahead with starting, you know, the first step of the future way of expending student organization funds or finance board funds. Any other questions or like comments or before we move on? Sure.
Oh, yeah.
So I know, like, in the previous meeting, we talked about, like, how, like, we couldn't have, like, students, like, distributing, like, merchandise from their dorm because that doesn't really, like, coincide with the university guideline of social distancing. So, like, if a student purchases stuff with their own money, like, after it's approved and they live on campus, like, would them distributing the stuff like disrupt like the guideline, or would that like not be allowed? Like,
yeah, so I think that's what the point of the ResGAF is going to be for, is that unless there's an SGA advisor signing off on it and a campus life advisor signing off on the purchase and like the operation of like, you know, dispersing of the merchandise, you can't go through with the expenditure yet. So that's what the ResGAF is there for, is to confirm what the process is. And I feel like campus life will probably come up with some way of distributing merchandise eventually, like in a safe way. But for now, I don't think there is a one, like, because since there's no groups supposed to meet in person, you can't have like merchandise, because that's basically like a meeting, you know, in person, even if you're just giving out t-shirts. So I think that's where it's at right now. And like, yeah, like I'm sure there's gonna be something down the road that they could use the tent, you know, in the spring or something to have stations, because I think they already handed out like welcome week boxes or something, and well, there would probably be a similar process for merchandise down the road, but for now they just want to make sure. I mean, you guys have been in classes for a month now and it's been good so far, I think, in terms of safety, but I think they just want to minimize the risk, you know, and like they don't want to start allowing things to occur if it starts to mitigate the safety precautions. Because once there's like an outbreak, I think they're just really worried. They don't want the whole campus to shut down and then there's no merchandise.
Pooja?
I actually had the same question as Aaliyah. So thank you for answering that. I have one more thing that I would like a clarity on. So usually reimbursement is for merchandise that student orgs buy or something SGA funds for merchandise. So like if we're allowing reimbursements, what other things are allowing? It's not like, if you're funding for merchandise, then there has to be a distribution of it, and so it's not clear on how it's going to happen. So, are we going to reimburse in that case?
So there could be like, you know, a weird scenario. I don't know what the clubs are doing right now. I haven't actually had any reimbursement requests submitted to me, but like if there's something that needs to be paid for online, like that's the other thing is like the ResGap can be there if I approve it or if it gets through the approval process and I can tell the club like, hey, this expenditure can be done. There's a possible like there's a different process for paying with the ResGap or like paying for things. Like you don't have to do a reimbursement, you know, like I do have a state issued credit card that still works for like online subscriptions or like I don't know like if Zoom costs money or something for clubs to subscribe to. Those types of things that, you know, there's no actual package involved, those things can be paid for and processed. They just have to go through the ResGap first. So like, yeah, there's no, you don't, like the clubs don't need to go out and pay for things themselves when like that thing, whatever they're buying, if it's an actual product, it can't actually be distributed. So there's no point in like going through a reimbursement process. So that's what the ResGap is there for. It's to prevent clubs from going out and spending things with their own money and then expecting reimbursement. That is to confirm, you know, not only do you have the funding, but is this purchase going to occur, you know, on campus, or something needs to be done to pick up and delivered, you know. Those are the things that the ResGap is going to go through, like reviewing. I think I saw Tori said something. Yeah. Yeah, that's the other thing is we reimbursement is kind of like a last scenario. Like we would like it's easier for you to just use my I have a state issued credit card, or I can go through like the UMBC's Amazon account. But in order for those things to occur, like I need the ResGap approved. So yeah.
Any other questions for David? Liam? Liam, are you muted still?
Yeah. Oh yeah, sorry. I think you did email me, Liam. Sorry about that. Yeah, all the emails are gonna go out tomorrow for the rest of the SJ students. I've finished like half of you guys so far, or like started the process. But yeah, you'll be receiving the email from me tomorrow about what to do. On what documents you need to give me to get on SJ payroll. I can look now. I think Liam is. Yeah, Liam, I'll have to work with you individually as a new hire. Thank you for the patience too. Sorry about that. It's a weird process because of COVID. Like, there's two tech. If you're a brand new hire on campus, like if you haven't had a job on campus, it's like two different DocuSigns you have to do. And like I already submitted some to some students and they got both DocuSigns that weren't necessary. And it's kind of like a weird process for right now. So it took me so long to like sort out who needs what. And yeah, it's going to be finalized tomorrow. Like everyone's going to get the final email of what they need to do.
Hey, anyone else? I'm not seeing or hearing anything. Just real quick, there is no like update on any on the process for purchasing and distribution.
In terms of like for student orgs, no, not yet. Rashad submitted to me a request for gift cards to the bookstore for a giveaway that SJ is trying to do. Once we finish the ResGAF with the DocuSign, I'll be able to process that. Actually, I think Candace already did submit one, but I do have a student working for the my business center that is on campus for limited hours to do like the rare instances of there is like a pickup, or I think the gift cards, though, we looked into it, they're just like a code, so there's no real pickup to that, but they weren't accepting my departmental card, which is like a flex card to pay, so I have to go in and try to pay with my credit card, but I'm waiting to hear back if I'm allowed to do that on campus, since it's like I usually pay for things with a department card, but since they don't have like an online portal for that, I have to pay with a credit card. But once that's finished with Candace and confirm with business services, I'm going to try to finalize that payment for the two bookstore gift cards for like a giveaway or something.
Okay, thank you. All right, final call for any more questions, comments, concerns. Walden. All right, I'm not seeing or hearing anything, so I'm going to assume that nobody has any more questions until we get to our, you know, board discussion. If there's nothing else, then David, thank you for coming to this meeting.
Yeah, thank you all. Sorry, I don't have more information yet, but I'm sure there'll be more information coming as the semester goes on. I'll definitely like email you guys to hop in on a meeting once I get more information, whenever it comes out. But I just want to say thanks to everyone and thank you for your patience, and good luck with the semester so far. I hope everyone's doing all right in this weird semester. And I'll see you guys soon, I think. And if you have any questions, if any weird things that come up later on, you know, like you get a weird request from a group, just shoot me an email, I can definitely help out.
Great. Well, thank you again for coming. Hopefully we can work on this more in the future, but you know, current circumstances. But
yeah, sorry about that, everyone. Have a good night.
You too.
Thank you.
Alrighty. So before we get on to our board discussions, we're going to squeeze in a quick confirmation for the election chair, actually. So I move to amend the agenda to add a new section for the confirmation of Caleb Cagle as the election chair. Pooja seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see or hear no objections. So by general consent, the agenda is being amended to add a new section called confirmation of Caleb Cagle. And I'll pull up the JL for that real fast. But here we go. So Caleb, if you would like us to do a quick introduction of the board, we can do that, or you can go ahead and just jump in to your introduction, but it's up to you.
Yeah, I don't think that's quite necessary to introduce everyone else, take up anyone's time. So just real quick, we can go through this and then, you know, vote for it or against it, that's fine. Real quick, hello everyone, my name's Caleb Cagle. I'm a senior IS major at UMBC, and I was nominated for election board chair again. If in case you were with me last semester during the elections, I hope that was a wonderful process for you. I know it was definitely great working with you all last semester. And I go by he, him pronouns as well. I should definitely make sure that I said that. Going from that though, I guess some reasoning, I guess, behind why I was nominated or why I would be a good fit for the position of election board chair is obviously I did it last semester, right? I'd like to think that I did a pretty decent job. And the only thing that I'd really like to do moving forward is address some of the things that I felt were kind of lacking last semester, especially now that we can be prepared with the concept or kind of the reality of the fact that we're probably going to be virtual again for spring. So instead of focusing our time and efforts on planning events and planning our budget around, you know, trying to make sure that people go to these events and get educated on the entire voting process, we can instead focus all our efforts and we could probably even reduce the budget for election board without cutting any of the costs for actually giving the candidates their campaigning funds and just focus on that instead and focus most of our efforts. That's one thing that I definitely want to address that I feel like I should definitely bring up with finance board. Beyond that though, I feel like I have a lot of leadership experience throughout UMBC and throughout my time outside of it. I've been a peer facilitator five semesters, and it's been a wonderful experience. I love working with all the freshmen. And I loved working with Beatrice and Candace as a leadership peer facilitator before Campus Life got their budget cut from COVID. And yeah, I don't want to make it too long-winded, but is there any questions related to that or related to the position that I was nominated for?
You guys can move into a period of questioning if you would like to.
I moved to move into a period of questioning. Is that how you say that?
Yeah, that's fine. Just seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see here no objections. So by general consent, the board is moving into a period of discussion on Caleb Cagle as a confirmation for the chair of election board. And that sounded butchered, but if there are any questions, comments for Caleb, now's the time to ask. Joshua?
Yeah, the first one for you, is this questioning or discussion?
It's questioning. Did I say discussion?
I may have, I don't know. Okay, but it's fine.
You're questioning.
No. Okay, thank you. Caleb, so from your experience last year, well, I'm sorry. First off, my name is Joshua. I serve as the Vice President for Student Organizations. I use he, him, his pronouns. From your experience last year with the election board, what is one thing that you want to carry over to this upcoming election cycle? And I asked this question specifically with COVID-19 restrictions being in place.
So obviously, I don't know if we'll be on campus for sure or not next semester. My guess is 90% no, from what I've been gathering from faculty and staff. So obviously, we're going to continue with the virtual elections, right? I think for the most part, Joshua, I hope that you could maybe attest to this. I think that virtual campaigning for you all was pretty successful for the most part. I honestly think that we could not have got the numbers that we were down a little bit compared to last year in terms of numbers, but it overall I think was not that bad, all things considered, with the rush scramble of like, oh, we're getting sent home and then having to cancel all our plans. I think honestly it was definitely a testament to the amount of campaigning that you all did that were running last year. So I'm with the same amount of people or with like the people that are going to come back, they're going to bring a lot of their own people. And since we won't have to kind of split our resources or focus any brain power on trying to plan events in person anymore, we can just focus on trying to flesh out some of the online ones. So one thing that we had was at SGA page where we had everyone's photo and bios. I do want to do that again, and I want to flesh it out more. Last semester or last year, I wanted to do a bi-weekly or a weekly kind of highlight of maybe like one person who's running for finance board, one person who's running for Senate, one person that's running for any of the executive branch positions as well. And it kind of wrote on the SGA website or even through my UMBC that this was something that I wanted to do but wasn't fully implemented due to time constraints. As well as, like I said, I do think that since we don't need to plan any stuff in person, right, we don't really need to incentivize individuals to come to these events and find stuff out, right? Like, we don't have to give out any prizes. We don't have to give out those parking tickets that I was, or not parking tickets, the parking passes that I got from parking services. So we can kind of cut the budget as well, use that money better elsewhere. I know that everything's kind of strapped for cash right now. But those are some of the things that I want to do and some changes that I definitely want to do as well. Is I think that the board, due to like how kind of last minute we kind of wrapped it all together, I do think it was a little bit unfairly made. I think it was a little bit too male heavy or male identifying heavy. So one thing I want to do moving forward is also bring in some more identifying members so that way we can have a better, well-rounded approach. And I see we have a Pooja has a question as well.
Yes. Hello, Caleb. I think I talked through emails when I was running for candidacy. So good to talk to you again. My question is, so last semester, there were some restrictions on how we can promote virtually, like using digital platform. And it was candidates' responsibility of making sure how they are getting promoted by people who are supporting them. And in my, like, there were some strict rules. Are you, as a chair of election board, looking forward to make virtual campaign a little bit more flexible, or are you planning on sticking with the old rules?
I think for the most part, it went through a pretty judicious process throughout the board, because anytime that a violation was reported from another, like going through the entire process of submitting a form, then it had to be reviewed not only by me, but by the entire board. So it was an entire board decision. So any times that we actually went through with something was something that we actually had to have a majority vote on. So all of the stuff, any of the correspondence that I send out, the emails were all either, you know, majority or unanimous votes. I was very, very fortunate to have some returning election board members last semester. I'm hoping that we can, since we'll be having some returning ones as well, that we'll be able to continue with kind of what we're doing. The entire process, if you're unfamiliar with running in previous semesters, because I don't know if that was your first one or not, it is pretty rigorous, I would say, or pretty strict in terms of how we want to be maintaining that the kind of validity of all the campaigning and for the voting itself. And we want to make sure that all the constituents are educated in what's going on throughout the process as well. So that's why all the stuff that I have to officially announce whenever somebody is suspended from campaigning, whether that we're doing like 24-hour suspensions or 48 hours, depending on how many times like it was going on. I feel like we were pretty lenient. We typically started maybe with like a warning, depending on the severity, up to usually we'd start at like maybe a 24-hour suspension and then go on from that. But we had no expulsions or like disqualifications. I don't think that there was any severity reports that seemed to deem that. But moving forward, I think that it is important or kind of imperative that we continue to stay kind of strict on that, because we, especially in the virtual environment, while we can't have our eyes everywhere, it's important that when other individuals do report these things, that we do actually follow through with them, and we don't just look at them and give it a slap on the wrist or be like, oh, they didn't mean it, or no harm, no foul, right? We can kind of tell when there's foul play involved or not from some of the digging that we do. So I think most of the time we are pretty lenient though.
All right, are there any more questions for Caleb? Joshua?
Sorry, my last thing. So you spoke about this earlier about trying to get more female identifying candidates in the field. So my question is, when it comes to outreach and promotion, do you have any ideas as far as outreach is concerned to international students on campus, to adult learners that are undergraduate? Like, do you have any any ideas as far as tapping into those populations, such as working with IES or OCSS?
Are you talking specifically for voting, or are you talking about for SGA, like run, like for individuals to run for SGA positions?
Individuals to run for positions.
So the problem with some of those individuals that you listed is that I know specifically for adult learners, majority of them are not considered or not full-time students. So if you are not considered a full-time student at the main campus, doesn't matter if you're taking classes like Shady Grove or anything like that, you are not eligible to vote, nor are you eligible to actually run. I don't believe there's anything specifically for international students. I believe the main thing is that you just have to be a full-time student at the main campus. So we have tapped into OCSS before. We had Lloyd Ekpe, who was on our board last year. He graduated. He worked at OCSS, and he was our kind of contact on the inside as well as the faculty members. That being said, though, in terms of what election board's makeup is this time around, I'm hoping to have a varied pick of who we're going to be bringing on moving forward. I know last year we had a pretty good one. The only thing that I wanted was more female identifying ones was all. But in terms of like where we were able to cover, I think Lloyd within OCSS, and he also was in the arts and humanities, dealing with some international students and with some, he was also a transfer and a commuter student. So he was a great resource. Same with John June. He was a great resource as well, being a commuter. And he also, I believe, is an international student. He won't be able to return this semester, unfortunately, since I believe he returned to his family in Korea. But that's kind of my incentive right now is maybe to, I guess for international students, I never really thought about that pathway. I'll have to double check with Candace to see if they're eligible or like what the eligibility may be falling into that. But if we want to try to target them more, I think a great place to start would be with the Mosaic Center or any of the kind of transfer systems. I know I've been focusing heavily on first year students or transfer students with my IHU courses. I always start SGA stuff at the end of fall and throughout spring.
All right, any more questions? I'm not seeing or hearing any requests. So, with that, I move to end this period of questioning. Pooja seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see or hear no objections. So, by general consent, the period of questioning on JL07-21 has ended. Now we can enter a period of discussion. This period of discussion is only for board members, so Caleb, you unfortunately may not be able to participate. But if anything that has been misconstrued or if you hear anything wrong, you may be recognized to help clear that up. But with that, is there a motion to enter a period of discussion?
I move to enter into a period of discussion.
Pooja seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see or hear no objections. So by general consent, we are moving into a period of discussion on JL07-21. So if anyone has any comments, concerns, thoughts, discussion points, please let me know. Joshua?
Yeah, I think that Caleb would be great for this position. He did an amazing job last year. I definitely sent him probably about 100 emails. He was very attentive to all of them and helped walk us through the entire process. So thank you for that dedication last year, Caleb, and hopefully this passes and you will do a good job this year.
Pooja?
Everything I just want to echo everything Joshua said. And to add on to that, I think what Caleb has is experience. And I think that is that could be very valuable for us, for SGA to have in a chair of the election board. So good luck, Caleb, and I'm sure you'll do great again.
Yep, just to echo what everyone says, he seems very fluent and knowledgeable in everything election board, so I definitely feel comfortable with him taking up the chair position. Elia also agrees in the chat. Are there any more discussion points, thoughts, concerns? I mean, I'm not seeing or hearing anything, so we can go ahead and end this period of discussion. So if anyone would like to make that motion.
I move to end the period of discussion.
I second.
All right, are there any objections? I'm not seeing or hearing any objections, so by general consent, this period of discussion on JLO 7-2021 has ended. Now we can approve this document for voting. So is there a motion for that?
I move to approve JLO 7-2021.
4 seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see you're hearing no objections, so John consent. JLO 7-2021 has been approved for voting. Like always, please put your vote in the chat so all members for. All right, it looks like a unanimous vote for. So congratulations, Caleb. You have been confirmed as the election board chair.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone, for all your kind words. It's really touching. Thank you.
All right. You're free to stay for the rest of the meeting if you would like, but you're also free to go. So
wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yep. All right. Thank you for coming. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and finish up this amendment. I didn't finish typing it out, but the plan is to go on and discuss the semester budgets based off of the information that Matt gave us earlier, just so that we can get on the same page, you know, think of maybe some solutions that we can work through or maybe something. If there was any point of clarification you needed. But if anyone would like to make that motion to enter that discussion while I'm typing up this amendment from earlier. If not, I motion to enter a discussion on the semester budgets.
Second.
Are there any objections? Right, I see or hear no objections. So by general consent, we are entering a period of discussion on semester budgets. So if you have anything, question, comment, concern, discussion points, points of clarification, please let me know in the chat. I know it's been a minute since we've had all this information, but Joshua?
Yeah, I think that for me, the main thing is, again, going to the conversation of setting expectations. And for me, when I see semester budgets, automatically I think of the former structure of you submit your budget, it gets approved, it gets denied, you can have your event, you can't have your event in the next semester. But that's not going to be the case because there is so much uncertainty on what's going to be happening in the spring semester. So earlier I mentioned to some folks in a prep meeting that we should continue with the HUP-to-HAS process just because I feel like as we get information on a rolling basis, it's also safe for us to approve applications on a rolling basis. That way we can work with the tide of information and not against it. During that same call, Tori mentioned something of having that process be in place, but having some type of additional system to make sure that there is some type of continuity in the evaluation. So I definitely invite Tori to represent that because I'm blanking right now. But I think that SAHAS is like an ideal process to maintain for the spring semester just because it's so safe.
Yeah, I can elaborate on what Joshua was saying there. Kind of echoing what I was hinting at with Matt's conversation, we're not going to know what's going to happen until we know, right? So I know that's not an answer that anyone wants to hear, and it makes things obviously very difficult. But something I had mentioned was kind of, you know, just going with the flow up until a certain point and then making a decision. So maybe we're okay with not knowing until mid-October, whatever that looks like. Maybe not waiting that long, but also keeping in place the semester budgets specifically for those groups that we do know are going to have things next semester virtually. So our competitive groups, if we have groups that know they want to have a speaker virtually, so we're not punishing the orgs that are already doing things that they want, but keeping the SAHAS pot like we are this semester in addition for spring in case things change that they are allowed to do things online, or maybe an org was just holding out and they didn't want to commit to anything yet. So those were just some ideas I was throwing around in the pre-meeting.
Are there any questions for Tori about that? If there are no questions, I'm going to assume that you understand what she was saying. Any other questions, comments, concerns? If not, I really just wanted to talk through maybe a potential solution with you all. I mentioned to Matt the possibility of pushing for virtual events and keeping our deadline for submitting semester budgets, which at the moment is like 2-3 weeks away. I'm not entirely sure, but I know that it's on the timeline that Candace, October 15th. So either we send out the information saying, hey, push for virtual events. If you're trying to plan an on-campus event, as Matt said, you can put the request in 25 Live. Just know that we're not going to do anything with it. Or we could push back the deadline. That was something that Candace mentioned, I think, last week in our pre-meeting, but she's not here to elaborate. But I was thinking in the past like 10 minutes, you know, what the possibility of doing both at the same time would be so that student clubs could, you know, wrap their heads around, you know, events that could happen, but we also don't want to get their hopes up. Tori?
I would suggest against going down a route of having orgs submit through 25 Live, just because I know it helps Matt out, but it puts a lot of hope and unnecessary work in for student orgs if we're just going to be telling them no. It also adds a ton of extra work on you all to approve these budgets just to take them back. I think if we hear some more stuff about, yes, spring things can happen, here are the guidelines, and that happens this semester, definitely rearranging some budget deadlines around from that and kind of going with the flow. If we haven't all noticed by now, the theme of this year is go with the flow. Until we know better, I am going to highly suggest that we don't encourage groups to submit just for them to do work and then get mad that they're doing work for no reason and then having to switch their plans around to try to make it virtual. I think pushing virtual and then if on campus becomes an option, then hooray, we get to work with that. But saving everyone involved some extra work and time and frustration is probably in the best interest of everyone's sanity.
Yeah, that definitely makes sense. Are there any questions? Do we want to discuss further about a potential solution disregarding 25 Live? Aaliyah?
Yeah, I agree with what Tori said, and I think that if we communicate to the orgs all the information that we have, that how the spring semester is going to go, we don't know yet. But right now, you should plan to have it on online events, and then if we get more information and new information, or if anything changes, we'll update you. So we kind of just tell the orgs everything that's happening.
I definitely agree with that method. I was going to say something, but my brain just blanked. Joshua?
I was in the process of typing in the chat, but I was like, why am I even doing that? So this is to Aaliyah and Sierra, just because you two would be the ones basically sending out the correspondence on the decisions made to student organizations. What do you think is a good timeline for this decision to be made? Do you think it's next meeting, the following meeting? How close can we get to October 15th before sending something out?
Well, I just checked my handy dandy calendar and we're about 2.5-3 weeks out. I was thinking that I don't want to cut it close, especially if we're not going to push back any deadlines such as the semester budget. So I feel like the decision should be made by next week. But Aaliyah has something in the chat.
I just wanted to clarify, by decision, did you mean on what we want to do with the spring budget, if we're going to push back the date or keep it, or what we're going to tell the orgs about submitting, about the process for submitting applications for the spring budget?
Right. So a little of both. So the process of submitting their budget for the spring semester, whether or not they still have to do that or not, and then also, if they don't have to do that, what's the alternative? Are we pushing back the date? Are we going to continue with the HOTS process with particular deadlines in act, or what are we doing as a board moving into the next semester?
Tori?
I would, just as a thought, I would suggest keeping the budgets, what timeline, I don't know what that would look like. I don't have an opinion on that, but I think it, even if everything is still virtual, prioritizing those orgs that are doing the work now, and they are thinking about spring and they are trying. So the groups that are going to be competing virtually, the groups that know they want to be doing an event, keeping those semester budgets so that those groups can still be, I guess, rewarded for doing the work they're supposed to be doing already, and that their hard work is being taken into account, and then potentially leaving Sahas actually open versus closed off for any org that didn't. So similar to this year, and allowing all orgs to still use Sahas versus just the new orgs.
Aaliyah?
I personally was thinking, like when I talked to Candace, we were kind of talking about, well, last time I talked to her, we were talking about pushing back the budget for the the deadline for the spring semester budget, because like this is kind of like how like all of this came up, like when I was like making the template email and like I sent it to Candace, and then she was like, okay, you should talk to Matt to see if this like information is still true. So like because of like all of that kind of like so some orgs, I don't know if they were really keeping up with it themselves, but like we never sent out the September email yet because we were still like there was still like information that we didn't know yet, so we didn't like communicate that to the groups yet. So I kind of thought like it would be best to like push it back in case like orgs weren't like they didn't get the email yet, so they weren't like thinking, okay, what do we want to start planning about it. But that's just what I was thinking.
Rashad and Siri, I don't know if you saw Joshua's question in the chat, but he's asking about when we should possibly know about budget constraints for next semester, if you have anything that could answer that.
Repeat the question.
Josh was asking, when should we know about budget constraints for next semester? Basically revenue coming in that informs the SGA budget.
We have like a concrete plan on what the state of the next semester is going to be like, whether we're fully on campus or not.
Figures. All right. Well, to go off of what Aaliyah was saying, I feel like cutting it close like right now is a bit. I don't know how to phrase it. I don't know how to phrase that. I hope I can convey to you what I'm trying to think, but I feel like if we can get that information out like now, and direct them towards ECS and Matt with their contracts and all that jazz, they might be able to reach the October 15th deadline. Granted, they need signatures. And that's a big thing, that, not getting your advisor signature in on time. But I guess something that we could think about is leniency instead of pushing back the deadline. But if we provide that leniency, it might bleed into other semesters and other boards. But I guess that's something for us to decide. Aaliyah suggests that we could do a vote if we would like to keep the deadline or change it. Is that something the board would like to do? Before I give options, do we want a set date for it to be changed, if that makes sense, or is that going to be something we can work on or decide what that deadline is going to look like. I have no idea if you understood what I just said. I kind of don't understand what I just said. Yeah. Joshua, is that for Aaliyah or for this changing the deadline?
That's for, I don't know if you can hear. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. That's for setting a specific date if we were to change the deadline. I think that, because it sounds like it's going to be a meteor, like a meteor heavier conversation. And so if we hold that off until next week, I think that we can dedicate more time to it. So that's what that comment in the chat was.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you for clarifying. All right, so we're just going to do a quick straw poll then. To vote on if we want to keep the deadline or not. So option A, I'm gonna type them in the chat as well, is gonna be keep the deadline as it is for semester budgets, which is October 15th, or option B is gonna be change the deadline date to be determined. So please leave your answers in the chat.
So I'm just going to say out my vote because for some reason my laptop is left. So I'm going to have to disconnect and reconnect. But before I do that, I want to go for option B, change the deadline. And I will be rejoining.
All right. It looks like majority for B. I guess that settles it. We're going to be looking to change the deadline. I'm not sure if that's going to require like any legislation for that, but I can look into that outside of the meeting. So yeah, this discussion is definitely going to be on the agenda for next week. With that, are there any more questions, comments, concerns regarding semester budgets and how we may be able to move on from here? I'm not seeing or hearing any requests to be recognized. So if everyone is comfortable with it, this conversation is just going to happen next week. So this period of discussion can be ended. If somebody would like to make that motion. Oh yeah, communication.orgs. I don't know. Has anyone sent out any information regarding the September email talking about semester budgets? Like for the liaison system? I'm going to take radio silence as a no that nobody has sent that email, which, you know, makes it a little bit easier for us. Yeah, I feel like it would be easiest to tell them what Matt told us, especially if he's going to go through ECS and talk about what their process is going to be like. Yeah, holding off on the deadline would personally be... again, I can't think of what I want to say. I would appreciate holding off on telling the orgs until after we choose a deadline, because at the moment, I assume that none of them know what the deadline originally was, if that makes sense. But yeah, Aaliyah, if you have any questions, I mean, we can work on that outside of the meeting. That can be brought up next week. If you're okay with that, of course. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I feel like orgs would just wait until last minute, because that's what I would do. But, I mean, yeah, if you don't mind working on this outside. Yeah. Okay. Is everyone cool on this? Does everyone understand what's going on? We're going to choose a deadline, or maybe discuss about a deadline, not necessarily choose, but hopefully we choose it next week. Next week, we're going to figure out what to send out to orgs regarding this, this change next week as well. Is everyone cool? I'm going to take general radio silence as a yes. Rickmon?
This is kind of like an off-topic question, but when do we find out updates for spring semester in terms of COVID and if campus will be open or partially open?
Everyone that I've talked to and every source of information that I've had has said Thanksgiving break. So really late in the semester regarding like our timeline. So,
and even then there's no set date.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Anyone else? All right. I'm not seeing or hearing anything. So we can end this discussion. I'll just go ahead and make the motion. So I move to end this discussion on semester budgets. Joshua seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see here no objections. So by general consent, we are ending this period of discussion on semester budgets. And for the interest of time, since Anjali is here, I would like to amend the agenda to add another section for a new confirmation. If I can pull up the correct, a confirmation of Anjali for an appeals board member. I can restate that because that was very sloppy if you need me to.
Hold on, I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anjali Bashal. I'm a junior and I'm a bio major. And yeah, that's just my brief introduction. So do you guys have any questions for me?
Yeah, real fast before we get into that, we have to add you to the agenda. Mm-hmm. I made that motion, but I can restate it real quick for the rest of the board, but it'll take like 2 seconds.
Okay.
I amend the agenda to add a new section for the confirmation of Anjali Bashal as an appeals board member. Joshua, are there any objections? I see or hear no objections, so by general consent, we are adding a new section for the confirmation of Anjali Bashal as an appeals board member. And Anjali, we can do a quick round of introductions of the board, if you're willing. If not, that's up to you.
Yeah, that sounds good, yeah. I would like to get to know everyone.
Yeah, all right. Well, I'm Sierra Dubuque. I'm currently serving as the chair of the finance board, and my pronouns are she, her, hers. And we're just going to go in alphabetical order. So Acha, you are next.
Hello, my name is Acha. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I am a finance board representative. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Hello, my name is Aaliyah. I am the vice chair of the finance board, and my pronouns are she, her, hers. Nice to meet you.
Hi, Aaliyah. Nice to meet you.
Hi, Anjali, I'm Courtney. I use she, her, hers pronouns. I serve as a coordinator for student organization development and campus life, and I'm on the finance board advisor.
Nice to meet you, Courtney.
Anjali, my name is Joshua Gray. I serve as the vice president for student organizations. I use he, him, his pronouns. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Liam, if your mic still isn't working, you can go ahead and introduce yourself in the chat. But Rashad, if you would like to introduce yourself, you can. If not, we can move on to Pooja.
Hi, I'm Rashad. I'm the SCA president.
Hi, I'm Rashad.
Hello, Anjali. This is Pooja. I am a finance board rep, and I use she, her pronouns. Also, Sierra, please, Sierra and everybody else, please keep an eye on FB finance board chat because I'm not able to type in anything in this chat, so.
Hey, Anjali. Good evening. My name is Rahman Liaquat. I'm a finance board rep. My pronouns are he, him, his.
Hi, Rahman.
Okay. Hi, my name is Victor Kende. I am a finance board representative and I use EMA's.
Hi, my name is Siri. I'm the treasurer and I use she, her, hers pronouns.
Hi, Siri.
Hi, I'm Tori Heasley. I'm the coordinator for student organizations. I serve as a finance board advisor and I use she, her, hers.
All right, now that introductions are done, if you would like to give a little bit more about why you chose to be an appeals board member, I don't know if you chose it or if you were nominated, but if you could just go into that a little bit more before we enter a period of questioning.
Mm-hmm. So I was actually nominated by Kai and Rashad. So I am interested in appeals board, however, because I feel like I don't, besides the two connections that I have, I don't know many, like anyone in SGA. So all of my decisions would be very impartial and there would be no favoritism at play.
All right, thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Is there a motion to enter a period of questioning for JLA9-2021?
I motion to move into a period of questioning.
Joshua seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? All right, I see you're hearing no objections. So by general consent, we are entering a period of questioning on JLA9-2021. So if you have any questions for Anjali, now would be the time. Joshua?
Hi, Anjali. One quick question. Can you just for clarity sort of flesh out what the position is just so everyone on the board is clear and just to see what you perceive this position on the appeals board to be?
Thank you for your question. So I was informed by Kai, actually, the appeals board meets based on like appeals that are that happens during the semester. So they don't meet weekly and appeal. I believe it is whenever someone files for an appeal, that is when an appeal board the committee meets and they make a decision to go through with it or not. I'm sorry, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Hold on. Sorry, my connection is like cutting off.
Yeah, that seems like a lot of issues for a lot of people right now for WebEx. So that. Any other questions? Last call. I'm not seeing or hearing any more questions, so we can move to end this period of questioning.
Hello, can you guys hear me? Sorry, I stopped hearing anything. But should I continue?
If you have more to answer, then
As I was saying in my introduction, since I don't have like that many, I don't know that many people. So in any case where like any of the parties, they feel violated, then I will be able to make an impartial decision based on that.
Thank you for your answer. There's a final call for any more questions for Anjali. Again, I'm not seeing or hearing.
Sorry, I had one question. I know you were nominated, and I was wondering that, or maybe Marshawn can speak. I guess we're supposed to be asking her a question. I was going to ask her if she knew, like, did they explain to her why they nominated her specifically?
I'm so sorry. Could you repeat that? It's like breaking up.
I can actually answer that. So Anjali was actually appointed to, she was nominated to run for appeals board last year, but due to her class conflict, she couldn't go through with the confirmation. So she did express interest in getting nominated again and running for the position again this semester when her class is, you know, less less compact, I guess. So you know, we put her name forward, but me and Kai know Anjali, and you know, we know her work ethic and the work that she does. So I just want to put that out, but you know, I hope that answers your question.
All right, any more questions? If not, I move to end this period of questioning on JL09-2021.
Motion to move period of discussion, period of questioning on JL09-21.
Is there a second? Joshua seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see here no objections. So we're drawn to this period of questioning on JL09-2021. With that, is there a motion to enter a period of discussion?
Motion to enter a period of discussion.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Are there any objections? I see you're hearing no objections. So by general consent, we are entering a period of discussion on JL09-2021. Anjali, for reference, this period of discussion is only for board members, but if you hear anything that may have been misconstrued or may have been confused for something else, you are free to clarify anything. But with that, are there any discussion points, thoughts, questions, concerns regarding Anjali as a nomination for the appeals board? Joshua?
Anjali just seems like a great candidate for this position. I think what she mentioned a few times, her impartiality in the entire process of evaluating these different appeals that may come in. So I think that that definitely puts her as a prime candidate to hold this.
Definitely, and given her dedication to it last year, even though she may not have been an appeals board member, I think that really shows dedication for the position this year. So I am in favor. Anyone else? Getting a couple of agrees in the chat, but if there's nothing else, we can go ahead and end this period of discussion. If there's a motion for it.
I move to end this period of discussion.
Joshua seconds in the chat. Are there any objections? I see we're hearing no objections. So by general consent, we are ending this period of discussion on JLNI-2021. With that, is there a motion to approve JL9-2021 for voting?
I move to approve JL9-2021 for voting.
Second.
Are there any objections? I see or hear no objections, so by general consent, we JL9-2021 has been approved for voting. So again, leave your answers in the chat. All finance board members for. Yeah, thank you, Acha. All right, it is a unanimous vote for Anjali to be an appeals board member. So congratulations, Anjali. Thank you for coming to this meeting as well. Unfortunately, Sonia could not make it, but I appreciate you guys or you coming in.
Thank you all. Thanks for having me.
All right. Congratulations. You are free to stay for the rest of the meeting if you would like to, but definitely not going to hold you to it. But with that, we can move on to a discussion on reimbursements and merchandise and marketing fee. If you all feel comfortable discussing this, I know that David didn't have an update for the merchandise and marketing fee. But we can talk about reimbursements and if we as a board plan on pushing, not pushing, but, you know, telling student clubs that that is an avenue. But it is up to you all if you would like to have that discussion. Aaliyah?
I know he said that they're like almost done, like you almost have the form ready. So I think we should like maybe like draft up an email, and then like once we have like once the form is officially available, then we should send it out. Because like there's just like kind of no point in like doing it too early. Like if something happens and then something changes and then like what we say no longer stands, I feel like it's just best to do it once everything has already happened.
Yeah, that's understandable. So would we like to enter Pooja?
I agree with Aaliyah, and I think it will be best if we communicate all the information that we have so far to orgs on the types of reimbursement that are potentially able to be by university and SGA.
So is everyone cool with waiting until we have like the form ready and like a concrete decision before we communicate to clubs and orgs about reimbursements?
Hey, yeah, sorry, question. Speaking of the forms, he mentioned we might already have it on our website. Did anyone see it already? By he, I mean David Warrior.
Yeah, I don't know if that was more of like the virtual ResGAF or like other supporting documents for it.
Okay.
But yeah, I'm not sure what he was speaking about then. But
yeah, we can just email him in.
What was the question? Sorry, I was away from computer there for a second.
I was referencing how David Royer mentioned that we might already have the forms we need for the reimbursements on our website. And I was wondering if you could verify that.
I think Candace has them. He said he was working with Candace.
Okay.
Unfortunately, that does not still does not give you an answer, but
I mean, if everyone's cool with waiting, I mean, we never formally entered a period of discussion, so we can either like completely skip it or enter that period of discussion. But I mean, you can let me know in the chat. Yeah, Joshua says skip it. I'm feeling like it's a skip it. So, I mean, if nobody's going to oppose, we could just skip it and move on to the Finance Board Liaison check-in. So, I mean, if you have any updates, now would be the time to let us know. I'll give you like a minute, 30 seconds. I mean, if nobody has any more updates or any updates for liaison check-in, we can just scratch that too, and we can move on to announcements. So if anyone has any announcements, please let me know.
So I wanted to ask about the application for next semester. So is that going to be through SIAS or no? Because I don't know how to ask this. I'm like very confused, but yeah.
I think that's something that we can work on. I think it also depends on, you know, how next semester is going to turn out, because if we're on online again and, you know, we decide to cut the student activity fee again, then that will change how we look at it, if that makes sense. But
yeah, so basically it depends on if we are going to be on campus or not next semester.
I think that's the baseline for it. But Sir, yep. Is that in response or another question regarding this?
Yeah, I was gonna say, it's kind of like 2 points, like what Victor was saying. I think we voted to extend the deadline, right? So I guess that's where we're going with it for now. And I guess we'll have to like wait and see how next semester goes. But of course, if it's all online, if it's like this semester, then we're gonna follow the SAHAS format. But also to tie back into one of Joshua's questions about budget constraints, like when Michaud and I and Candace created a budget, we left next semester like untouched. Basically, we didn't cut any like funds for next semester because we're just preparing for it to like go back to in-person mode. That being said, you know, we all saw how late we got information for fall semester. Like, let's be honest, even when we were on the committees and we still got information pretty late. So I'm not really expecting any decisions until definitely like probably after Thanksgiving break. But if they decide we're gonna stay with this in-person mode, then we're gonna have to go back in and probably make some cuts, you know, especially with students' activities fee, we're gonna have to vote on that again. And if we cut that, then you know we're gonna have to make budget cuts and go from there. But today we definitely voted to extend the deadline, so we have to decide a date for that. And I think we just kind of have to like go with the flow in a sense from here on out, because ECS is telling us like they're not approving any on-campus events for next semester. So we just have to kind of work around that and work with the information we have.
Yeah, that's like my life motto right now. But Tori?
Yeah, Siri kind of covered it all, but just as like a simple point, Victor, for an answer, there is still going to be, I lost my words. There still is going to be a budget semesterly based on what is voted on right now. There's still going to be semesterly budgets, but that deadline to submit will be pushed to when. That is something you all have to decide on. As it stands right now, so this is something you'd all have to vote on later and decide on, there will not be the SAHAS pot the way it's set up this semester for next. That doesn't mean it can't turn out that way, but as of what you all have voted on so far, it would be semesterly budgets and that's it. So I would recommend in the future, depending on how things go, opening up SAHAS to be for everyone again.
Yeah, thank you. I think that makes sense. But...
All right. Come on, you have an announcement.
Yeah, thank you so much. So I hope, so proud of all of you for making it this far in today's meeting. So I just wanted to let all of you know that tonight, starting at 9 p.m., is the UMBC Presidential Debate Watch Party, powered by the Center for Democracy and Civic Life. I hope to see all of you there.
Question, does it require a reservation or can I just show up?
That I am not sure of, but let me get back to you.
Okay, thank you. Siri asked where exactly.
It's virtual, of course. And I think I can send a link to you soon. One sec.
Great. Well, thank you, Rukman, for bringing that up. Definitely looking forward to whatever link you have. But if there are any announcements, any other announcements, just drop it in the chat. Let me know.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Okay, perfect. First of all, I just want to apologize. I had a quick announcement. I'm driving right now, so I'm going to make it really, really quick. This stems from a conversation that we had in Senate yesterday and from the fact that SRC is really, really close. The first SRC for first quarter is very, very close. If I'm not mistaken, it's this coming weekend. So I just want to have a really quick conversation with everyone in the finance board just to make sure that we're all keeping each other accountable for the work that we're doing. So, you know, I'm not saying that you guys aren't doing the work. I'm saying you guys are doing a phenomenal job, and you're one of the strongest bodies in SGA, and I'm really proud of all the work that you're doing. But I just want to keep that in mind, right? You are accountable for the work that you do, and you are also accountable for the work that your fellow finance board representatives do. And if there's any area where you see someone is lacking or, you know, needs help to get the work that they need done, please reach out to any, first of all, please reach out to them and see if you can help with them. And if you can, please reach out to any of us so we can help with them. But yeah, I just wanted to make that note just because SRC is really close and, you know, we have to stay cognizant of the spaces and the resources that we're taking.
Yes, definitely. We're all here to help each other and I don't want anyone to lose out if they're struggling. But yeah, this Friday is when SRC is meeting for the first time. So, I mean, I guess if you have any questions, Aaliyah would be the person to go to for that. But yeah. Aaliyah?
So our SRC meeting is on Friday. So if you haven't completed any of the forms, the deadline is today. So, you know, you want to have all your forms so you can get a good rubric thing. So yeah, please do that if you haven't already. Thank you.
All right, are there any other announcements? I I'm just checking to see if Pooja hasn't. Rahman has sent the link in the WebEx Teams for the presidential debate watch party, just so everyone is aware. But if there are no more announcements, we can go ahead and move on to adjournment. For final roll call, I recognize that Acha is present, Aliyah is present, Joshua is present, Liam is present, Pooja is present, Rahman is present, Siri is present, and Victor is present, as well as ex officio members Courtney, Rashad, and Tori. And I will go ahead and stop recording. Actually, I adjourned this meeting at 7:33 p.m. Now I'm going to stop recording.